Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How's everybody doing today?
Very good.
Great.
Before I start my discussion, I think it's important that we recognize the magnitude of the event in that this is a very, very dark day for Toastmasters in that I'm speaking. So we'll take a minute.
Of silence?
Or four and a half. Of silence to commemorate this dark occasion. I gotta tell you, I'm a little bit nervous. I have a tendency to speak a lot, as most people know. Nobody's ever told me I don't speak enough. But to speak up in front of people on particularly this subject is a little bit uncomfortable. I'm not as dithyrambic as I might be. And that is in definition number one. If we start talking about definition number two, that's dithyrambic. Talking about myself is not easy, but because it is the icebreaker, I'll go ahead and push through. It's a lot of mishmash of, you know, where you're born, how you tick, and all kinds of things that I haven't really figured out yet anyway. But I'm going to throw it out there anyway. So, it all happened, you know, back in August of 1960. The sun was shining, birds were chirping, beautiful summer day, children were playing, and all was right in the world. All waiting for the arrival of mwah. At least that's my story. My mother, on the other hand, would say, it was 3 o'clock in the morning, it was a dark, cloudy night, and there was thunderstorms all over the place, and they actually thought that there was a tornado, but they weren't sure. So there's the two differences. Born in Toledo, Ohio, went to high school in Toledo, inner city high school, and I used to tell the joke that I was really about 14 years old before I realized that horses weren't born with men and little numbers on their backs. But, you know, it's really not true. I was 13. Going through high school, I was what you would call your typical underachiever. I would always say that I'm never typical at anything. I was an overachiever, underachiever. So I was very, very good at not doing what I should be doing. Got through, but I did graduate in the top 95% of my class. So that shows you I must have been doing something right. There was that 5% that was below me. Went right from high school to the service. And shortly after I was in the Navy, I got married to my beautiful wife, Tammy, lovely bride of going on 32 years, which I joke that I'm up for parole and she's up for sainthood. So I think that's the point, though, in getting into the segment of keep going. I think that's what, well, there's no doubt that my wife turned my life around. It wasn't until that time then that I started to realize or had the motivation to actually try to achieve something. It's one thing to work for yourself, you know, just try to improve yourself. It's another thing to have something to do it for. And that's what my wife gave me right from a very early stage. Once in the service, I became that non-studious underachiever and became very studious. It was important for me to learn, not just to learn, but to learn for performance. I knew what I was doing now. I knew I was supporting my wife and eventually a family. I knew why, now all of a sudden, why I wanted to learn what I needed to learn. Ended up being kind of successful in the service. One of the things that I'm most proud of is that I was the first person of my rank on my second ship to achieve the position that I achieved. It's an engineering officer of the watch, which generally is only served by officers. I was a first class petty officer when I did it, and it wasn't heard of. As a matter of fact, I got a certificate from the 7th Fleet, Commander 7th Fleet. So I was very happy about that. But it was because I now knew what the focus was. Once I got out of the service, which the motivation there was that we had my eldest daughter, I eventually came to work for Consumers Energy. Temporary janitor is how I started in this company at the J.R. Whiting plant. I, to this day, will tell you that I clean the ashtrays and the toilets better than anybody there at the time. That's my story. My mother doesn't have one on this one, but some other people might. I became an operator at the Whiting plant, moved on to being a shift supervisor there. Got to the point of realizing that shift supervisor's job, well, that's not a good job. That is a job where you're between a rock and a hard place, and anybody that interfaces with first line supervisors, particularly that level, they have all of my respect. They have no way to turn. They have to be strong all by themselves because they're not getting support here and they're not getting it from below. So that led me to the power pool in Ann Arbor. I became a coordinator for the Michigan Power Pool, which was a joint operation between Consumers and Detroit. Then we moved over here where I became the supply operations superintendent at Consumers, where our function is to regulate and control and interface in the market for all of our generation. The key for me in all of this is coming from someone from an area that really didn't have a lot of motivation, really didn't care about achieving, to know that there's reasons why we do what we do, and then to realize those reasons, actually long after they actually happen. So that's a little bit piece of me, and thank you for your time.